those data in, to bring the data in, that compared to Kaiser, we were significantly below in hypertensive treatment and LDL and hemoglobin A1C. And the minute those people saw that, their behavior changed. Yeah. And I think that was the single biggest factor. Yes, sir.
It is impressive to be able to bring competitors to collaborate together, and obviously demonstrate some really good community-based approaches. I guess my question would be, and you had your community work, you had others, putting the patient in the center of his or her journey, helping them to learn how to have the self-efficacy, the capacity to modify the disease trajectory, to get excited about those stories that you told, have a little tear in your eye when you do it and stuff. That to me is the missing piece in most of the things that we as clinicians have done, and that we change insurance design, we change healthcare delivery systems like ACOs and primary care medical homes, and we change clinical criteria, which is what you did. But if the fourth part of it, meaning the self-management of that individual, isn't front and center, I don't think the gains are going to last. I don't think they're going to do other things that they need to do to improve their health. So I wonder if you feel like, whether you did it systematically or not, have the participants and their neighbors and friends and all the rest actually change their behaviors, change their attitudes in some way to give you those better results?
Well, we did, as long as the health coaches were there. I mean, we've surveyed the patients. Patients felt that they were benefited by that. There was a focus on their health, that they had a greater understanding of the potential benefit of intervention. You know, because oftentimes we say, your blood pressure is high, take this medicine. And the patient walks out and they don't see the relationship between taking the medicine and an event 20 years. And so I couldn't agree with you more.
Did you use evidence-based behavior change programs that are based on theory and based on things that have been shown to work, so your coaches weren't, or others weren't just talking about what it was, but actually using evidence-based approaches, similar to the evidence you use for medication?
So we had healthcare coach training sessions, and we brought in professionals. There's a group at UCSF that are really, really good in terms of that. And we, you know, we brought the healthcare coaches in and we trained them. But there was a limit, there was a definite limit to the evidence base here. First of all, the healthcare coaches were all kinds of, we made a decision early on that every one of the participating groups should have their own health coach. So some of them had pharmacists, some of them had nurses, some of them had psychologists. There were a spectrum of different people who served as healthcare coaches. One of the healthcare coaches was the daughter of one of the managing physicians who had some time to kill after college and became a healthcare coach. So, you know, but whatever worked for them. Now we trained them. We trained them all the same. And we had no evidence of how the training took them, and we didn't have specified checklists.
That'd be my criticism, because there is a 30-year or more research on health coaching, on behavior change, on self-management support for a lot of different organizations. We actually have one that digitally delivered on a 30-year history in person out of Stanford, but there are a number of those. And I would hope or suggest that in the future, with additional ones, you would try to use those kinds of approaches, because if the patient is the most important person in this equation, and particularly for adherence and for all the other things that you want them to do, to leave it just a chance compared to the evidence of whether you go from a 60 to a 30 LDL, maybe the bigger difference is what the person does with their own behavior.
So Dr. Kaufman, I just want to say that the University of Best Practices strives very hard and has since the very first one that Tony chaired in February 2011 to be absolutely evidence-based. And it is a very committed group. And you can't find a more evidence-based leader than Dr. DiMario, who was the editor-in-chief of the Journal of the American College of Cardiology for 14 years. So I think that one of the reasons we're seeing such an intense and impressive decline, 2,735 fewer MIs over the first 3 years of that project than were anticipated based on trend, is because of the evidence-based approach that was used. So thank you for raising that. I know that, Tony, you need to leave pretty soon, and I'd like to just say that...
But I do want to address that. You make a good point, but I would say two things. That for all the research that's gone on in the past and all the science about the efficacy of coaching, wasn't being done. We did it. You know, we may not have adhered to the optimal techniques and methodology, but we made the decision that it was better to implement something and that it would be best implemented by each individual institution based upon what they had. And the second thing I would say is our adherence data are pretty good. And we've got the health exchange. I didn't go into that, but some years ago, we had a huge grant, like $25 million grant, and there's a health exchange in San Diego that everybody participates, all the healthcare institutions participate. The patients have to opt out. You've got to specifically opt out if you don't want your data in the health exchange. So we can go to that health exchange and get some pretty good data. So, you know, we are subject to the critiques that you brought up, but I would say that in the real world, we actually implemented something that didn't exist and that we've got some evidence that it was a benefit.
You got it, Lee.
No, but I think the outcomes of San Diego are just remarkable. But so along the lines of the healthcare health information exchange, so you're saying you think that also attributed, because I'm trying to think of what we're doing in LA. So, you know, we're going to, it really needs, if it worked in San Diego, why not LA and all the other counties? But in LA, as far as I know, we don't have this health information exchange. How much do you think that's contributing?
I don't think very much. I mean, they haven't even got it.
So it was all
they haven't even gotten it organized till about a year ago, where it was of any value. But it was good for us checking what we did. But I don't think it played too much of a role. But it did. I mean, San Diego is easy. You've got the ocean to the west, Mexico to the south, the desert to the east, and L.A. separated by 30 miles of military. And so we're sequestered in the southeast corner of the country, and it's easy to do. So thank you very much for listening.
Tony, would you like to hear the first few minutes of Scott's presentation? Joel, can you get Scott's slides going?
Sure.
So, Scott Flynn,